Hi, I'm Fred McNeil, and you're watching QACTV 7. Thank you very much for being with us. Every week, we bring people on the show, and we talk about issues that affect you all over the county. The biggest issue that the 40-plus years I've lived here in Queen Anne's County is always development. As soon as somebody says they want to develop something, somebody's either for it or against it. Well, in Centerville, we have a very special area, Judge Carter's Farm, beautiful house, the prettiest tree in Centerville. And I think some people are talking about doing a real good job in developing it in a certain way which will reflect their special community. So, Rebecca, with that introduction, just tell everybody who you are and who you represent. And you're a ex-runner, a biker now. Anything you want to talk about.
Hi, Fred. Thanks for having me here today. So who's Rebecca Flora? Well, I live in Chestertown. Moved to the Eastern Shore about 10 years ago.
Where'd you grow up?
I actually grew up in the Adirondack Mountains in very small towns.
Really?
So I'm very excited.
You traded mountains for a bay?
I did. And it's kind of, but the same small town kind of feeling and the landscapes. It's really great to be here. I'm really happy to be in this stage of my life.
Good.
In this kind of place.
And a great place for riding bicycles. You told me you're riding bikes a lot now.
Wonderful. Just did the Shore Rivers ride on Sunday.
Did you ever do the Chestertown 10-miler?
Cycling?
Running.
I did that when I first came to Chestertown.
Memorial Day weekend. I did that for years.
It was a great wonderful run. Back in my running days.
Only one hill, if I remember, right?
That's the great thing about Kent County, certainly. We're in Queen County now, but not a lot of hills compared to Pittsburgh, where I spent a few years.
By the airport. There was always a basketball. I used to coach basketball. Nike put on a clinic. Green Tree Marriott.
Oh, yeah.
You know what it is? And I used to run in my running days. Lord, I went from the Eastern Shore to Pittsburgh running. Almost killed me.
Very different. Yeah.
And a great town, by the way.
It's wonderful to be living in this area. And I have two little grandsons, 4 and 6, it's so special. They don't live here. They actually live up in New York City. But that makes it even more special for them.
The last person in that chair was in it. We were bragging about New York. Once a year, Queen Anne's County Parks and Rec sends a bus up to New York City for the day. We go to Sardi's for dinner. We see a play. And then you know what? Thank you, Lord. I'm going back to Centerville. Right? I love New York City, but us bumpkins can't handle it. I can't handle it.
No, it's nice to visit. And I love the fact that I can,
Are they actually in the city?
They're right in the city.
Oh, great.
And my daughter teaches up there.
Oh,
and
bless her heart. New York City.
It's nice that the little boys can come here to this lovely place as a little escape now and then. So
they're probably looking around, Grandma, what are we going to do?
Well, I am MMA. So they enjoy it here, too. I can get them down here. Of course, the last year has been a little challenging.
Been a mess. I get the New York Times every day. New York, what we've gone through in the Eastern Shore, nothing to compare with these poor New Yorkers.
Oh, I feel grateful.
Between a governor losing a job, the mayor has got his hands tied. Anyway, look, you didn't want to talk about that. Rebecca, like I did in the intro, we have a wonderful part of this town, Judge Carter's property, and truth be told, I live right next to it. So I want to make sure everybody knows. Hey, Fred, you've got a hidden agenda here. No. You have a great idea of what you'd like to do with that. So how about I'll be quiet. You tell me what you're up to.
Okay. Well, thank you. We have to thank the Eastern Shore Land Conservancy, first of all, Rob Etkin, who introduced us to this piece of property. The in-town location where, people could walk. Everywhere was extremely attractive.
Get to the water, get downtown, restaurants.
Absolutely. Not to mention the fact that, it's just this amazing piece of property just sitting there right in town. And so what we've proposed, and we've been working with the town over a year now, actually 2 years when we first started the conversation, picking up where the Eastern Shore Land Conservancy left off, because they did community conversations.
How about explain that to the public? There's a little confusion. Originally, some folks bought the property, am I correct?
Correct.
Now, how did the conservative, so give me a timeline.
So it's been 10 years now.
And 10 years.
Since the property actually, since unfortunately.
It's been empty for 10 years.
It has been empty for 10 years.
A tragedy for the house, but we'll get to that later.
It really is. And I've had great conversations with Rachel Carter, daughter of Judge Carter, who's very supportive of what we want to do.
There's vultures living on top of that. It's a tragedy.
Yes, they do. It is very sad. And Rachel went through the house with us recently to see, know, what has transpired. Yeah, but she's been supportive of what we want to do. So what we want to do is actually something that will be, I think, a whole new unique model for the Eastern Shore and an incredible positive contribution to Centerville. And it's called an Agri-hood.
Okay, Agri-hood.
Hood. Exactly. And so what that is, you know, people build golf course communities, right, and it's centered around a golf course. Well, this is a community that's centered around a working farm.
Okay.
And so the notion that it's Agri-hood and a neighborhood. And they're being done around the country. And we really felt that this was a perfect location. My development partner and I, Ernie Soda, who's been really, this has been a career goal for him
to do a project like this.
And
well, I mean, where are the Agri-hoods, their neighborhood? Where are some you know about?
They're all over the country.
Any locally?
There are a couple of developments, I believe one near the Easton area that has promoted itself as an Agri-hood. There's a lot of range and differences. Sometimes it's just some grazing and it's on the edge of town. A lot of times they are more on the edge of town. Okay. So this is unique for us to try to be doing something this way in town, which creates this wonderful amenity for people throughout the town to be able to walk to fresh food. So our whole goal, because what
so not only are we going to have houses, we're going to have a chance where you can walk up and, hey, when tomatoes are...
Okay, farm stand.
Yeah, oh, great.
Basically. And so this whole notion of how do you develop in town, mm-hmm, where basically, rather than the edge town, so that people are walking and being part of the town,
right,
the main street and the wharf and everything that it offers, but then also to create this amenity where we're actually creating local food.
A service for the community.
Yeah. Close to people. Because even though we live in this... I found this interesting moving here a few years ago. Even though we live in this amazing, lush, beautiful agricultural, mm-hmm, area, we drive by it.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I mean, we might go to the farm market or go to a farm stand, but the ability to just walk up to a farm stand is, I think, will be new and pretty exciting. So that's the centerpiece of this project.
So we're talking, let me make sure. So we're talking, there'll be housing, but to be part where the community go in, get fresh tomatoes,
correct,
get fresh corn, that type of thing.
Right, because this would be vegetable.
So we're not going to close off that property. It's
going to
be open to everybody.
In fact, a lot of what Ernie and I do, I mean, we've been doing, you know, development and in community, mm-hmm, development, mm-hmm, for our entire 30-plus careers, is, you know, trying to do low-impact development.
Okay.
What does that mean? That means basically incredibly environmentally responsible. You know.
So we're not going to have 500 tract homes. We're not going to have 1,000.
No.
We're going to have something that reflects the town of Centerville and Queen Anne's County.
It's unique in that people, it's a very unique kind of thing, because in some of the lots, mm-hmm, will not have necessarily a garage that you drive into, you shut the door and go away from everybody. It'll actually have a place where you can drop off things at your house and then go to clustered parking.
Okay.
A lot of the intent of that is to shift how we think things away from our car to interacting with our community and our neighbors.
With people,
And basically to get people out of their cars. And so that's one aspect of what we're doing. In doing that, it means less paving.
Okay.
Less paving means less runoff. And so everything that we're doing is to keep in mind, how can we make this an incredibly wonderful restoration of the habitat in that area?
Because there's deer back there.
Absolutely.
Eagles back there, I believe.
It's an amazing area. So we want to not only develop sensitively, but actually restorative.
Okay.
So we actually bring back some of that habitat, not only along the buffer, but actually within the site itself and
how about
be accessible.
How about, Rebecca, walk through it. Let's start.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm driving down Chesterfield Ave,
we'll
give them some mental visuals here. The beautiful tree, which everybody takes. Hey, my Chesterfield Ave has people just drive.
Oh, I have pictures, and I was there this spring.
We have a beautiful tree. We have the Carter House, mm-hmm, with, mm-hmm, the swimming pool. Okay,
mm-hmm,
let's go from there. So, kind of take us.
Yeah, and
I can hold it.
It's a concept drawing.
Okay,
and so this has not been approved. This is the result of a lot of conversations over the past few months.
Is that all right for you?
Yes, that works perfectly. With the town, and we've had this wonderful dialogue with the town to sort of
get to
this point.
Okay.
But it will actually start the public review approval process actually next month. And so,
and we'll get to that after you tell us where
let me orient you. And so this is Chesterfield Avenue right here. I believe, Fred, your house is...
Oh, we got to mark that special, Rebecca. Come on.
Yeah, okay.
The Nut House.
This is Chesterfield Avenue.
Okay.
And this is the Carter Farmhouse that everybody is very familiar with.
Gorgeous tree.
Yep, right there. So as you're coming down Chesterfield and you look straight at the farmhouse, that's where it is. And these trees are all those, what we think of as heritage trees that, assuming they are healthy, you know, that we will absolutely plan to preserve.
And we know Doc's restaurant down a couple hundred yards on the left.
Doc's further down this
Corsica
way.
Corsica River.
This is all the Corsica. Well, this is Yellow Bank Stream, and the head of the Corsica is over this way, right up this way.
Okay.
And so the wharf is down here also.
So we have kind of a feel for where we are. Okay.
Right. You're only a half mile walk into
town. An easy walk uptown.
So that's the beauty of it. We think we can bring more residents, shoppers, and a way to actually help with the Main Street in terms of actually making that more vital.
The beautiful, easy walk down to the river, all right, no problem at all.
Right.
Okay, and like you say, you can walk, docks is real close. You can walk uptown 15, 20 minutes, if not less.
Absolutely, and that's part of the why we were attracted to the site. It's its walkability, obviously its location. Surprisingly, there's not as many views as you would think. We're sitting up on a plateau. You actually aren't right at the water edge.
Right.
That's like 20 feet, 25 feet down a steep slope. But just to continue to walk you through, so you come in through Chesterfield Avenue, you know, as though you were going to the wharf or docks, and basically there would be a new entry right here to the site. This would be a public street. We will be, as developers, constructing everything that you see here.
Right.
That's our responsibility.
So the burden's on you to do that.
Our cost, absolutely.
And it'll be on town water and sewer, correct, or not?
It will.
It will be, okay.
It will be. We'll construct all of those lines.
They become your cost.
Construction, exactly. And so I wanted to really emphasize that, because even though we are doing that, this will ultimately become a public street.
Okay.
So there is full public access into the site. And so you would enter the site here. You would have the opportunity to basically visit the farm stand right here, basically.
And that will be right down from the Carter House, actually. Okay.
Right. Carter House is right here. This entire area here is being preserved, and I believe the acreage, we're holding firm to maintain at least 5 acres for a working farm.
Okay.
And so this
farm... That'll actually be a working farm?
A working farm. We will be recruiting a farm, an experienced farmer, who would actually would manage and maintain, and we hope even live here.
Okay.
And actually be overseeing
actually live on
that
the property.
Farm. That would be the ideal scenario, to be right there. And that's what would be happening here in the centerpiece area.
Well, let me interrupt. Will the Carter House, what I've seen the vultures do, I was inside it, I had a person show me the building. Will that stay? Does it have to stay? Or what will happen with that?
The Carter Farmhouse is very much part of what people think about when they think about this site.
Right.
And the commitment we have made is that we will ensure that the exterior of that house is preserved.
Probably gonna have to gut it out, maybe.
We're gonna need development investors. I mean, something like restoring that house to its full, once upon a time, it's over 100 years old.
It's old fashioned, very chopped
up. We'll take more than what we can take on, but
will be a house, or will be an office, or what will you
we
see?
We don't know yet. Okay. I mean, Ernie Soto, my development partner in this, has done a lot of these types of historic rehab, so he's been through the house. It is still salvageable. This is why we want to be under construction next year before it does
deteriorate it falls in,
any further, because we don't own it right now, so we can't get in there and start doing that work.
So right off the bat, it'll be 5 acres, a workable farm, okay? And off of that farm will be a place where I can pull up, I can walk to, and
this
get tomatoes, corn,
public,
lettuce, or whatever.
We hope people will bicycle here and walk here and, you know, bring their children. And
the Tour de Centerville right around
Absolutely, okay. And create this wonderful immediate access to walk from lunch on Main Street and come down and pick up something for dinner. So that would be that part of it. You also see parking here, because that's to support what would be very limited commercial buildings here. There used to be a actual market.
There was a store when we first moved here down at the bottom of that hill.
So that's the idea. The corner market kind of thing would be potentially be there, and other types of services in an ideal world. Maybe there's a yoga studio there or something that's
all about
healthy
living. How many office spots are you planning?
Is
that still in the
right now, that's all still part of our approval process.
But there would be some commercial property there.
There would be commercial. And this is not like a strip shopping center. This is very low-key.
Fits in with the Centerville motif.
Corner market type thing here. And so we've tried to allocate enough parking that would service that and give the ability for people to come up and come to the farm stand. And so that's kind of the first thing you would see is some of that activity.
So as soon as you're going down Chesterfield, you still see the Carter House, and you'll figure out what to do with that.
Absolutely, that's that view corridor.
And then you see an entrance, and right in the entrance, there'll be a farmer's market probably, and a couple low-key commercial buildings, like you said, yoga, or maybe who knows what.
One of the things we really want to focus on for that commercial is food-centric.
Okay.
And so
all with your ag motif.
And so in an ideal market, we would be able to attract a farm-to-table restaurant here, for instance, that would make use of some of the produce coming out of the farm. That's an ideal, absolutely ideal tenant that would be in this commercial area. Yeah. And so this is no more than like 3,000 square feet.
Okay.
It's individual buildings, kind of very low-key here. And then basically the first phase of development that we are already talking to potential buyers for is actually what we call phase 1B, which would be about 25 single family units of housing. These are smaller cottage type houses.
Okay. Water view from there? Or I haven't walked back. Is there water view there?
It's in the fall.
Okay.
You would be able to see
leaves.
One. Okay. You would be able to see one. But let me actually jump to that point because the really cool thing that's happening, and this has been part of the discussions we've been having in the town, is to find really best solutions to how do we bring public access through the site. And so there will be two ways to do that. The first way we'll be able to basically get on this 5-foot wide perimeter trail that'll come along.
This is the famous trail we've all heard about, yes?
Well, there's two trails
Two trails, okay.
And so this one would be sort of more what you would consider this nature trail feeling.
Okay. And you'd get on that where?
You would get on it right off from Chesterfield.
Okay.
So if someone was coming from the Millstream Trail and wanted to kind of, you know, meander
veer
around,
off,
they could actually pick up this and keep their meandering.
Okay.
And it's all tied to the town's bigger plan for a green belt in the town.
Okay.
And so we would connect to that green belt and whatever else wants to.
And you
to
get on the existing trail on the other side of Chesterfield Ave.
Exactly. So
right
our connection starts right here. This is one of our connections. And this is more of a nature trail.
And this is a public trail?
This is public. And it would come down through here and go all the way around through the site.
Oh, the whole property.
And come back out here to then connect to...
And where is... Give me the Board of Ed. Where is here?
The Board of Ed property is over here.
Okay, basically. So this comes out kind of like where the Board of Ed property starts?
Pretty much.
Okay.
Now, the one thing I have to caution is that... this hasn't been approved yet.
Okay.
It has to go through Critical Area Commission approval.
We're talking what perhaps you'd like to
do. We are talking about what we would like to do and what at least our conversations with the town, would like. And town being town council.
That'd be a great trail.
Would like to see happen, and that's what we're committed to try to make happen, and we're all going to work together towards getting those approvals. The other really fun thing about this trail is that there's two other aspects to it in addition to this really different kind of experience, and that's two overlooks. And so we've planned for what we're calling the Corsica River overlook right here, which ultimately will line up with a view corridor that we know
exists. Is that kind of near the is that near like where Tim McCloskey lives? Or
Tim's further down,
so this is
closer to the wharf. And so there's a corner house right here, an existing house.
Right.
And so if you enter kind of right there off from Chesterfield.
And you could see the Corsica River.
You would come to this overlook where there'd be an opportunity, and we'll position it where there's the best opportunity to see the head of the Corsica.
Okay.
You can also access this from this other trail that I'll talk about in a minute. So there's one of these overlooks here, and then there's a second overlook that's an entirely different experience, which is towards the marsh.
Okay.
And that overlooks, you know, in a very opposite direction. So we're trying to...
Two spots where you stop, take a break.
Absolutely.
Look at nature, look at water, get a little bit of everything. Okay.
And so those are part of this plan. The other public access part of the plan is not only is this a traffic entry spot for cars to come through and loop through the site, but as part of this is also what we call the Chesterfield Trail, because this was the Chesterfield property. And this is a different kind of trail. This is a trail that we call multimodal. That you and I
and public like to access, be on our... Public access?
All public.
Okay.
You and I that are now...
Bicyclists, joggers.
Shifting from runners to cycling.
Young mothers with babies and carriages.
I call it the shake, rock, and roll trail because, you know, whether you've got a stroller, perhaps, you know, a wheelchair, your bicycle, or you're just out for a walk, this 8-foot wide... trail.
8 foot wide, so that's a nice width.
Right.
Yes.
So, and it's paved, and so it's fully accessible. Would also come through the site, and it would come in at this point. This isn't a sidewalk. This is a very different kind of experience because you can have all those things happening
at
the same time. You could come in through here and also come out to the trail or to the overlook at this point here if you were coming from that viewpoint, or connect to this other overlook from this stage here.
So this comes all the way
through the site, also adjacent to the public roadway, and both of these are public accessible routes through the site in addition to being able to actually
And you're going past farmland and there'd be some residential areas.
It's gonna be a really, right now I know there's people that walk on the site, and take their dogs and everything, but it's kind of limited. This will actually open up the property.
Everyone
for
I
others.
Know would be delighted, believe me, because it'd be much better than being in an open field or a cornfield. Mm-hmm. It'd be much better to be on a paved path or some type of path. Be probably a little safer.
And safety has been a big concern, and it's one of the issues that I think we were most concerned about, in addition to just steep slopes, buffer, habitat, but those were some of our concerns about really trying to be thoughtful and working with the town about this route, because there are all of those things that we had to pay attention to.
The length of it, any figure? A mile, 2 miles?
I would say a mile at most.
Okay. But it would be a very gentle walk. Very gentle walk.
And one of the things that we're doing is the U.S. Forest Service actually has guidelines for these types of trails and these types
what you can and can't do, et cetera.
Right. And so we're being very careful to sort of what those slopes would be and where we can route it to, you know, have minimal slopes to make it as accessible as possible. And so I think the experience of this will be so dramatically different from the experience of this trail, but yet are needed. Because I think both...
Well, a mom with a carriage is probably more likely to take this one.
Exactly,
Someone wanting a little longer walk probably would do that.
You know, the bird watchers, there's just so many different possibilities. I mean, we want to work with school groups. The other thing that I have not had an opportunity to talk with anyone yet at Queen Anne's school, but I believe the high school has an agricultural program.
Yes, great
there.
Ag program, yes.
We're really looking for, once we know that the project is actually kind of moving forward with approvals, because right now we're ready, but we do have to go through
a process.
Once we feel like that those are all starting to look good, one of the groups that I've talked to many groups, but one that we really want to talk to is the Queen Anne High School.
Get the ag folks in there.
Ag program, and really this farm, I think, has so many possibilities from being just simply crops that everybody gets to come to the farm stand.
Well, let
the
kids get in there and do some projects.
To the other extreme of training and opportunities to really focus and celebrate this agricultural place that we live in. And so a lot of possibilities there. So those are the public access areas. Like I said, we do have to get through approval
processes.
Has to
be approved. This is just talking. You're talking now.
From our standpoint, this is what we want to do. But we respect the fact that there's critical area commissions.
So show them again, if you would, it was phase one. Go back to phase one.
Right, so let's talk about the phases of development now and what we're proposing. So phase one, which we would be moving forward on first, is 25 homes. It's in this
area.
Just 25. The site is really challenging, which is more... It's very obvious why nothing has happened in 10 years.
Well, it's funny. I mean, slopes, right?
You've got major slopes. You know, you've got the entire critical area, the buffer on this side. You have all of that. You've got even this little peninsula slopes downward.
It sticks out,
You're really surrounded. There's really, this is the only connection to an existing street grid of the
town. Nothing back here. There's nothing.
I mean, it's a very... oddly shaped, so in terms of just even doing a layout that works well, was challenging.
It's a jigsaw.
Really challenging. And so that's been a lot of what the last 9 months.
So you're talking just 25 houses. What type of house? Give me a ball. You said smaller cottage type things?
These are what we're calling a cottage style housing. So it's not your big mega lot, big, what I used to call McMansion.
2-3 bedrooms?
There could be 2-3 bedrooms. We are trying to, we can't really know for sure where the costs are going to be until we get the site plan approved to understand what all of those costs are going to be. But we are hoping that our goal, certainly, is to ensure that, for instance, within this development, there would be housing available, for instance, some of these proposed townhomes down here, housing that would be available for a range of income types.
Teachers, firemen, whoever.
Basically, absolutely, from service, what we call those critical, you know, folks in the service industry.
Cottage size, Symphony Village size houses?
No, not bigger? Really that size. No, no, smaller.
Oh, smaller, okay.
And I'm not familiar with Symphony Village, but, you know, we are in the early stage design of those individual units.
But a smaller, just 25.
These lot sizes are pretty small.
Yeah.
The reason we've gone with these smaller lot sizes, but they would be 2-3 bedroom.
Okay.
But small lot and no garage, no parking pad. That all happens over here.
Okay. We park our cars in one spot.
Exactly. And the other part of how we're approaching this is that there's a lot of common space. So instead of everyone having their own big lawn, they share a grand lawn and they share a common house. And so there can be things that can be shared rather than being each individual house having all of the bells and whistles. Okay. The other really cool thing about this particular first phase that we're designing right now is that all of the homes will be designed to meet net zero energy standards.
Okay.
And so
which means what for the...
That means that basically any homeowner that wants to come in here and add a solar array, for instance, would be able to do that.
They can do that.
And there would be no energy use happening in this
geothermal
place.
Possibilities?
You know, we haven't explored geothermal yet. Okay. I mean, we're basically designing a house that would have minimal energy use, yet high ventilation, so they're healthy, enough so low that you could supply the entire energy use of that house with a solar array.
Okay, so that can be done. And the individual would have that choice?
They would have that choice. Okay. The house would be ready for that total plug-in.
Okay.
And so that's...
So phase one's 25 houses.
Correct.
Common parking area.
Mm-hmm. And that reduces paving. So what we've done and what we're really grateful to the town for, to be thinking creatively with us and what we're trying to accomplish here, is we've introduced the concept of what's called a woonerth, which is a very...
A what now? Say that.
A woonerth. W-O-O-N-E-R-F.
This is a family show now. Let's be careful.
It's a name that came out of Europe.
Got to be German or something, yes.
But it's Dutch, actually.
Okay.
But the whole concept, which is easy to understand, is it's a living street.
Okay.
So basically, kind of how we think of alleys in some ways, except in an alley.
Like city, like the city.
But an alley is still very vehicular focused.
Yeah,
it's very car focused.
Cars.
This is very pedestrian focused.
Okay.
So the idea is
park your car and
priority
walk.
For pedestrians, priority, making it safe, making it livable, and everybody shares the street, which actually slows people down.
Sure.
So we really want the car to, once again, not be dominating how people live here.
And the walk, people watching, the walk from the common parking area to one of those 25 cottages wouldn't be that difficult.
No, not at all.
Give me a yardage.
I don't know, yardage, but think a couple blocks.
Couple blocks, okay.
You know, I mean, we walk that all the time, you know, just getting to the store and parking. So, but there would be opportunity to basically come in, drop off your groceries,
okay,
whatever,
and go back to the common parking
here.
Okay.
So then we're not all staring at our car every day, despite I know some people love their cars very much. Mm-hmm. Instead, we're looking at green space.
Okay.
And so it's a different concept, and you know, we're not building 500 of these. We're building a small market that we know is out there and interested in this particular approach.
Very European way to live. Yeah.
Well, yeah, I would say it's American if you go back to some of our roots, too, really.
It's the way we should be living.
How we lived, you know, years ago before cars took over. Not that we all don't need our car.
No.
It just doesn't have to dominate our
life. Okay, so that's phase one, 25 cottages.
That's phase one. It's actually technically phase 1B.
Okay.
At the same time, so this is going to be developed.
Now, will we develop this area and that area together?
Yeah, we're going to actually make lots available. So if you decided you wanted to build a new home, make it something special, you can buy a lot. Now, there will be design guidelines to ensure that, you know, the quality of everything is
kind of fits into the,
fits
what we're doing here.
And, you know, has a high standard. But there would be the ability for someone to basically come in and buy a lot. And
build their own house, but meeting the standards of the community.
Not necessarily part of this community that's being designed as a community. So that'll basically be available on the market also at the same time.
How long would it take to ballpark figuring? If it is approved, mm-hmm. you get the approval, from the time of approval to get phase one done, year, 2 years, many years?
I think we could do it in a year.
In a year, okay.
Yeah, now, caveat, we're living in a very different world
now. Oh, yes, of course. Everything
materials, supplies.
You can't get a piece of plywood anymore. You can't get sheetrock. Yes.
There's some big unknowns out there in terms of supply.
Fingers crossed, if it was approved.
Let's say I had my permit today to start building construction. We would be in there, and it wasn't the beginning
fall
of winter.
Or the next year.
When the rain starts. Right. You know, ideally, you start construction when, you know, in late spring, when you can get a really good construction season in. But I believe we could basically have the first part of this access road complete and get moving
within a year.
These houses within a year. Is that complete and are people moved in? No, I mean, you're probably talking more like 18
that's
months.
Fingers crossed.
But this doesn't, I mean, actually the approvals process, which is important because it's a very unique and special site, will probably take us longer than the actual construction will.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. The first phase. I mean, obviously the whole thing will depend on market because we have to pay attention to what
the prices are going to be, what the cost of doing it,
absorption. There's so many caveats around the economy that all are variables that we can't control.
So let's say it works out, the town gets together, you get together. Hey, we can go phase one.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever that's finished, do we go right to phase two, or how are we going to do it?
That'll depend on market. I mean, I think we are very confident that the market is out there, especially since we're not building a 500-unit development here.
25
this
houses.
This is in total 125 units.
Total 125.
Which is less than the previous development that had been approved. Okay. And the reason it's less is that we've chosen to build less houses, which, you know, that means less money for us, actually, but in exchange,
you're keeping the integrity of
to keep
land.
This farm as really the centerpiece of all of this and to make it really something special.
Now, the other stages you already have in mind, if it's approved, what you'd like to do?
Yeah, we do. We have an idea. I mean,
That's flexible.
I mean, we have to at least be able to figure out what can fit and what the market is. And so that's what this reflects. And so this whole parcel two area is another 42 homes, which would be both single family on lots and the potential
for
townhomes.
How big are the lots here?
I'm sorry, Fred. I don't know that answer.
Don't worry.
I should. That's one of those numbers I need to remember.
Don't worry.
But the idea would be a mix of townhome and single family.
Okay.
How many of each will come down to where the market is at that point in time, but that's the type of housing that would be there. And those townhomes and these smaller lot sizes are really critical to ensuring that we can also have homes that would be reachable for folks like, you know, teachers, for instance, and particularly entry, you know, just getting started out on their career. And that would be a goal. And then phase three, I think, is the parcel three area, is really the area that, you know, once again, we've done a very high-level concept of how many houses could fit there, just for planning purposes at this point in time. We have allowed for the possibility of a multifamily-type unit there. Could be a condo-type thing, could be assisted living, could be something.
And that's still open for discussion, correct?
Open for discussion, small scale. And then we also have this other section called Parcel 3A that we've come up with to really allow the project to more easily blend in with the rest of the street because this is where we're closest
to
those existing homes. And so these would be very much of
the type of homes that are already in Chesterfield.
I believe so. I mean, we'll do the design guidelines, but the lot sizes you can see are even a little bit bigger here, here, and here to really kind of blend in.
So we just fit in with what's already on Chesterfield.
Exactly.
Now, Rebecca, let me ask you, because we're going to run out of time here in a minute. At this point, where are you and what can people do? One, if they want more information. Two, if they'd like to speak to you personally or your partner. So let's start right now. Where are we right now with the town?
Right now, I think where we are with the town is we plan to formally submit our plans to start that approval process next month.
Next month.
And so I anticipate, you know, we're working very closely with the town staff and council and planning commission on this, but I would anticipate being in front of planning commission in November-ish.
Okay.
Planning commission and town council during November, December.
Okay.
But then that's just the first step.
Step one.
There'll be multiple public hearings and steps that'll go all into next year.
And that's just a normal process that takes place.
Yeah, our first step where we will be officially presenting something.
Thanksgiving time.
Will be in November and in December.
Now, Rebecca, people watching this, no matter where they live in the county, if they'd like to contact you or your partner, what do you want them to do?
Yes, they should actually probably start with going to my website, remakegroup.com.
And do that two more times so they can go slow.
Okay, it's remakegroup.com.
Okay, so they can go right on the web, okay.
Yes, they can go straight on the web. And on my website, I have a project page, and you'll be able to go straight to the Carter Farm Agri-Hood Project and get a lot of details about the project. Eventually, once we know that we're a little further down through the approvals, we'll set up our own kind of specific project-specific site.
If they'd like copies of this, or you, that the wonderful pamphlet I have, how can they get that, or
this
what should they do?
This is actually on my website also, so if you go to the website.
Oh, they can just download it.
You can download a PDF
Fantastic document, by the way.
Today,
that's a great one.
Which kind of just walks
pictures
people
and
through
everything. Yeah.
All the aspects of the development. And you can get that there. Also, this most current site plan is on the website also, where you can access that. And the big thing is I'll be doing some updates there.
Okay.
And to just be looking for November-ish when we start actually.
And you're looking for input, am I correct?
We are. Okay. I mean, I think this is something that I have already reached out to several organizations. We've had a meeting with the neighbors. And, you know, we're listening. I think at the same time we're trying to help share reality sometimes of how this tenuous balance that we're trying to strike between what can work in this buffer critical area, you know, what's going to work from a market standpoint, from an environmental standpoint.
It's to be realistic, right?
From
be realistic.
Economics, all of those balances in the approval process. But absolutely would love to hear from people. You can email me, find me on the website.
Okay. Is there a phone number? It's okay if there isn't. Is there a phone number they can call?
Yeah, it's probably best to go in through the contact on my website.
That's
because
fine.
That way I can understand.
And repeat that one more time.
The website.
They all ran for the pencil and paper.
Yes.
Now they're
okay.
ready.
Okay. One more time. It's remakegroup.com. It's actually the title of my company.
Okay.
My development partner, Ernie Soto, is with Green Development. But that's the best place to start if you want to just reach out.
Okay, and you're looking for input, okay, like you said.
We are.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's a great project, but I remember I'm biased. I live right there. I love my empty field, and I love my deer, and I love my eagles, whatever, but I'd like to see some people on trails and moms taking kids around, et cetera. Well, look, our time's about up. Thank you for spending some time. Hope you come back again maybe around after Thanksgiving and see how that goes. I think the biggest thing you can do, Rebecca, is do what you're doing now. Inform the public, because I know there was some misinformation about the trails at one point, and they're going to put 1,000 houses in there, they're going to pave it all over. And I think the most important thing we can do for the community is just give them the correct facts, okay?
Absolutely, and I really appreciate you helping us with that.
Well, good, and you keep up your bicycle riding, okay?
I will.
We'll
wonderful.
See you bicycling around here one day.
It's great weather. I'll be biking into Centerville soon.
Well, great. Thanks, Rebecca, for coming.
Thank you.
My name's Fred McNeil. Thank you for watching QACTV7. Please keep informed in this project and other projects. I think more information you get, the less fussing you're going to do, all right? My name's Fred McNeil. Thank you for your time. My time's up. We're going to see you next time.